Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to Bangay Baptist Church, and we praise and thank the Lord that we're gathered here today to worship Him in spirit and this morning.
Oh God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. I will give everyone a moment of silent prayer to prepare our hearts and minds as we worship our Lord this morning. We will sing our first hymn, Is He Worthy? May you please request everyone to stand.
Yes.
glory and honor to you, for you are all worthy of this. We thank you, dear Father, for this day that you have given us. We thank you for allowing us, Lord, to wake up this morning, giving us this opportunity to once again, Lord, experience your love, your grace, your faithfulness in all of our lives. We come into your holy presence, dear Father, humbling ourselves to you, acknowledging our shortcomings into your presence, and we ask that they will forgive us, dear Father, cleanse us, fill us with your Holy Spirit, Lord, that our inmost being, our whole being, dear Father, our minds, our hearts, our soul, dear Father, would be fully focused in giving you our utmost respect and glory in worshiping you, dear Father, in spirit and in truth. Thank you, dear Father, for gathering us as a family that we could sing together, dear Father, in manifestation of your great love to us, and also, dear Father, thanksgiving to your name, dear Father. We pray that you will give us understanding through your Holy Spirit as we ponder, as we listen to your word, and may it will permeate our hearts, dear Father. It would be also a time that we could reflect on the lessons that you would allow us to each today, we could share it with one another during our big groups, dear Father. Once again, we give all the praises and thanksgiving to your name. We give back all these things. Thanksgiving to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
You may be seated. We will sing another hymn.
Thank you. Oh, word is to be praised. Once again, good morning.
Good morning.
So we'd like to greet our friends and family who are joining us online. It's our joy, and we are glad to have you join us. Before I'm going to give our announcements, let us stand up and greet one another with the love of the Lord. A couple of things to remember. Before the day, we would like to thank Pastor Jeff for taking the time to clean our building yesterday. Because that many fifth Saturday, usually siya nag-volunteer. Eh, wala sa schedule. So we thank him. Lisa Chamray. He took the time na maaaring yung pagkakapon. Maraming salamat sa store. And also for the flowers and decoration. Also, salamat man sa family Plaza and Sumagaysay for our lunch karon. Thank you so much sa pag-prepare sina. And also, we praise the Lord for giving knowledge and wisdom kay Brother Jen Ray sa iyong pag-hambati na sa Thai worship service. Thank you so much. Also, we would like to praise the Lord for a successful pastors and workers retreat, Rumprakon Baptist Fellowship dito sa Shamrai. Thank you so much sa inyong prayer. It was indeed successful and for keeping them safe. Pabalik sa inyong mga lugar na, no, from Shamrai. Also, please don't forget, tapos na ang inyong October break. Most of us will be going back to work next week, and some of us nagbalik na work last week. Ang hato niya, Saturday children's class, also mag-resume starting next month until the 9th of December. So we will have 6 Saturdays that tatlo na nag-volunteer. We need 3 more na mag-volunteer pa. And that would start next Saturday, the 4th of November. So, if you are available, can you check your schedule and pinat and more than pinat, mag-bless din sa ating network. So, as we continue to teach English sa inyong mga kapataan, and also pinat as she is sharing God's word sa inyong kapataan together with your family. And also, please don't forget ang ating Good News English, patayo na natin i-share sa ating mga social media pages. Hopefully, kung hindi man this year, by next year, maka-pick up kita. Kasabay kita, may isa na couple of students lang. No? So, please, may mga brochure kita din. Please don't forget to get and share this sa inyong mga students, especially sa mga high schoolers. Okay, and also patayo na natin yung team group after this, natin yung worship service. Also, may nakakaroon yung Bible training, mag-resume natin yung Bible training. So, please do stay. You are encouraged and invited to join sa inyong activity. And also, don't forget, another 25% sa atin yung balayaran for our family camp. And this month, October, visa. And also, 50% remaining dito sa venue, makakapagpagpagpag kita dito. So, namin niya hindi yan may hindi siya buka sa atong pool sa pagpagpagpag. And for those na wala pa naka-decide, kasi still have time to may November pa, couple weeks in December, we are encouraging you na namin din makapagpagpag punto mo sa ating family camp. Also, ating offering, please don't forget, we can do this sa ating offering lines or also sa ating online. Pastor Jeff will give us a couple of announcements for the month of November as we will be traveling to the Philippines. So, siya na magandang sa ating update. And also, thank you for your prayers and object. Kaya ko time sa atin leader.
Before we listen to God's word, we will sing one more song. Oh, how good it is. I please request everyone to stand.
Sunday and supposed to be scheduled in Joven Mawali Subong, but because on the 25th of November my brother-in-law will have his ceremonial wedding, kay a civil wedding was already done with embassy sa Singapore. They will just have the ceremony this coming November 25th. So we're going home, and I filed for a leave starting November 13. So I'll be preaching the first Sunday and the second Sunday. Amo na nga nagbailo ko ng Joven, ako mawali subong, siya mawali sa fourth Sunday. So on the third and the fourth Sunday will be both joint worship services. Our Thai brethren will join us for both Sundays. We will have no two services during those weeks. Si Pastor Riniel mawali sa third, si Joven mawali sa fourth. So that will be our schedule for this coming month. And we praise God for Brother John Ray, who shared God's word this morning during our Thai service. I'm not sure how long or how short this message will be, pero I'm sure ang sudan damo kun namin, so kung gutomon ka mo karon amaraman pinak mo amat-amat una sa likod or pagutom tatudo para ma-enjoy tagin ang panyagang ginapipara sa likod. It takes a village to take care of a child, but it also took a village to take care of my wife. So personally, I would like to thank every one of you who helped us, who prayed for us when we were in the hospital. I would personally would like to thank our personal nurse, si Miss Poppins, na upgrade na sa din sa minchin. For really taking the time to be with us kalin sa hospital hasta dire sa balay. The Libuna family who also cooked for us lunch and sa pag-check out sa amon dito, si Miss Blessy, si Magaysay family, amon arbolaryo nga nagtaklas ang tawa-tawa, kag si Pastor Daniel sa paglaga sa ginpasa siya sa arbolaryo. And for every one of you who visited us at the hospital, bisan may nag-apas na pa sa Manugwana, but we appreciate your love and the prayers that you have sent our way, and we praise God for His goodness that we were able to endure through this virus trials. So please take care of your health. Sa balay niyo man or sa eskwelahan, kay uso gid man sa buong dengue, I think bilog ni nga kalis ang isa kaadlaw gin fogging nila. Kay gapati ko, hindi lang dire nagka-dengue, but more or less dire sa sininga kalis damo man ang nagkalaigo. So please do take care of your health. James 2, will resume our study on this topic, partiality. We'll look at verses 5 to 13 this morning, but we'll only read together verses 5 to 7. James 2, verses 5 to 7. Okay, kunara na, all together, ready, begin. Listen, my beloved brothers, has not God chosen those who are poor in the world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which He has promised to those who love Him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Are not the rich the ones who oppress you and the ones who drag you into court? Are they not the ones who blaspheme the honorable name? Let us pray. Our God, we feel it is heaven to please you and to be what you have us be. Oh, that we were holy as you are holy, pure as Christ is pure, perfect as your spirit is perfect. These we feel are the best commands in your book, and shall we break them? Must we break them? Are we under such a necessity as long as we live here? Woe is us that we are a sinner, and that we grieve this blessed God, who is infinite in goodness and grace. Oh, if He would punish us for our sins, it would not wound our hearts so deep to offend Him. But though we sin continually, He continually repeats His kindness to us. At times we feel we could bear any suffering, but how can we dishonor this glorious God? What shall we do to glorify and worship this best of beings? Oh, that we could consecrate our souls and bodies to His service without restraint forever. Oh, that we could give ourselves up to Him so as never more to attempt to be our own, or have any will or affections that are not perfectly conformed to His will and His love. But alas, we cannot live and not sin. Oh, may angels glorify Him unceasingly, and if possible, prostrate themselves lower before the blessed King of Heaven. We long to bear a part with them in ceaseless praise. But when we have done all we can to eternity, we shall not be able to offer more than a small fraction of the homage that the glorious God deserves. Give us a heart full of divine, heavenly love. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Birds of the same feathers would normally flock together. It is but natural that we would be drawn to people of interests like ours. For example, in a gathering, one comedian said that he would just be naturally drawn to talk to another comedian. So the same goes with those who like sports or arts or chismis. That when we gather in a certain place, group yourselves according to your interests. However, our sin nature has also led to another flocking together, and that is called partiality and discrimination. In South Africa, it has been officially called apartheid. It is defined to be a former social system in which black people, particularly in South Africa, and people from other social groups did not have the same political and economic rights as white people and were forced to live separately from the white people. Now, what makes this concept crazy to me is that South Africa is not white. Africa is still Africa. It is predominantly black. But when the white people came in, the colonizers came in, the local black people were made a second-class citizen even in their own native land. This is what partiality and discrimination can do. So if this is what naturally happens outside the church because of sin, the part of the city you live in tells me about you. Even in this village, you will know kung sino din may kwarta, sino ang wala. Just by the part of the town or the village or the city that you live in. But James started his thoughts in chapter 2 that this should not happen inside the church among believers. He has established the principle in chapter 2, verse 1, that we should not treat anyone and everyone with partiality if we hold the faith in the Lord of glory, Jesus Christ. Because a true and living faith that obeys God's life-giving word is not compatible. It should not coexist with preferential treatment for the rich and discrimination to the poor. So our question for this study is still the same, starting from verse 5 to 13, because it's still the same topic. So why should believers treat everyone and anyone with no partiality, preference, or discrimination? Last time, we have established the principle in verse 1. Then we stated the first reason through an example in verses 2 to 4. The principle in verse 1 is this: our faith in the glorious Lord should not be held together with partiality. Show no partiality as you hold the faith in the glorious Lord Jesus Christ. And the example that he shows us, this scenario in verses 2 to 4, we've learned that believers show evil thoughts when they show preferential treatment for the rich. Believers show evil thoughts when they show preferential treatment for the rich and discrimination to the poor. Today, from verses 5 to 13, we will learn of four more reasons why. In other words, James is building a strong case here. The first reason was last time. Now we have four more why. One positive and three negative ones. Why, as believers, we should treat everyone with no partiality, preference, or discrimination. Look at verse 5. Listen, my beloved. Now this phrase is inserted not just to have a smooth transition, but that it is to really get his audience attention. I think effective communicators are doing this. Pamati, kamusta ako? Listen to me. Because though it is easy for man to be partial to the rich, God is not partial to them. To show partiality shows that we misunderstand who is important and blessed in the sight of God. When we assume that the rich man is more important to God or more blessed by God, we put too much value in material riches. Look at what James is putting our attention to. He says, has not God chosen those who are poor in this world? Because throughout the Bible, the poor are objects of God's special concern. Leviticus 25, if your brother becomes poor and cannot maintain himself with you, you shall help him, support him as you will a stranger, a foreigner, a sojourner. You shall assist him. Psalm 41, ang scripture reading tagina, the one who considers the poor, blessed is he. This is the point of Job. I was helping the poor. Why am I not blessed? Proverbs 17, whoever mocks the poor is equivalent to insulting God, his maker. Isaiah 3, the Lord will judge those who devoured and spoiled the poor, who takes advantage of the poor. Galatians 2, Paul is saying, they ask us to remember the poor. This is the principle even until the New Testament. So the statement that James is asking them here, has not God chosen the poor to be two things, rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom? These are two very, very beautiful and equal statement connected by the word and both of them gives value of what God did to the poor of this world. First, what did God do? While they are poor in the world, God has chosen them to be rich in faith. Then God has also chosen them to be heirs of His kingdom. To be rich in faith, what does it mean? Now the poor are chosen in the sense that the poor are more readily respond to God in faith, having fewer obstacles to the kingdom. In fact, since riches are an obstacle to the kingdom of God, there is a sense in which God specially blesses the poor of this world. What did Christ say? It is easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. This is a comparative statement using hyperbole. How? Can a camel go through the eye of a needle? My grandmother was about 80 years old, or I think sa 90 before she died. Like any typical old woman in the Philippines, she likes to sew things. Namin siya magtahi isang habol, namin siya magtahi isang bedsheet, halin pa na sa sako, ginagawa na namon. But at the age of 80 plus, she ginasulod niya ang hilo sa dagom without using glasses. But that's hilo sa dagom. How can a camel go through the eye of a needle? Probably Jesus, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than a rich person to enter God's kingdom. What Christ is saying, the poor of this world simply have more opportunities to trust God. Therefore, in a sense, they may be far more rich in faith than the rich man. Because this seems to refer to Matthew 11, where the poor believe on the Lord Jesus and found his salvation. When John the Baptist was in prison, he sent his disciples to Jesus to ask him, "Are you really the Messiah?" This is what Jesus answered his disciples. "Go and tell John what you are seeing and hearing. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead raised, and the poor have the good news preached to them, because this is the work of the Messiah." I believe Jesus also preached to rich men, but the poor believe on the Lord and found his salvation, while the rich despised, neglected, and persecuted him. That's why F.B. Mayer said, "The rich man may trust him, but the poor man must trust him. Because the poor has no other fortress, has no other hiding place in which he can hide except the two strong arms of God. While poor on this earth, but God has chosen them to be rich in faith." That's why church history demonstrates that comparatively more people than the rich have responded to the gospel. Now, while it is true that the once animistic nation like the Philippines, before the Spaniards came, we are predominantly worshipers of nature and spirits. Mga animista kita, we worship spirits and nature. But we started out receiving the gospel through Catholic missionaries who evangelized to our ancestors through the force of the gun. Tiko na muna imo klase sa evangelism. For example, kung ako missionary, may dala ko ano na pusil tayaan ta sa ulo bato na si Jesus, mabaton gagin man, di ba? Gagin pursa ka mo. But today, the colonizers are gone. We are comparatively way poorer than the rich, first world, high-tech, advanced Japan. I would hear missionaries from Japan complaining that the gospel work there is very slow. They're advanced, they're high-tech, they're rich, but why are they not receptive to the gospel? They are rich in this world, but they are poor in faith. But in the Philippines, when you preach the gospel, we have no other fortress but to look to God for salvation, for help. That's why comparatively, I think pila na to katuwig ang naghagad kay Justin makadto sa Amerika, sa Japan nga missionary. He's the one complaining. I've been here for so many years, but it's so hard to preach the gospel here. I just talked to a Burmese pastor a couple of months ago. He came from Burma. He said, I praise God for the war. While war is undesirable and it brings death and poverty, but he said, it is pointing my people to their need for God. So he praised God for the war. And compare that situation to this relatively peaceful, prosperous, self-sufficient country across the border named Thailand. This is why for many years now, I have stopped praying, thanking God for freedom to express our religion. Mga Thais, pero may sila ka pang umuwi. Salamat, Lord, sa freedom to express our religion. I don't pray that anymore because while we have freedom, peace, and prosperity, it has led this country to be self-sufficient. It has led them not to see the need for God. That's why James said, has not God chosen the poor to be rich in faith? And also, God has chosen them and made them heirs of His kingdom. And the kingdom that James is talking about here is the kingdom in its present sense of salvation. Those whom Christ rules, as well as its future millennial and eternal glory. So right now, the poor of this world is chosen by God, not only to be rich in faith, to trust in Him, but also to have Him as their God. And in the future, God is preparing them to be inheritors, heirs of His future millennial and eternal kingdom. So poor believers who are chosen of God unto salvation are rich in an eternal sense because we are iridira. We may be a nobody in this world, nothing to inherit like me, but we are waiting to inherit the future kingdom, but right now we have God as our King. We are part of His kingdom. All of this is possible because of God's choosing. So relating to what James is saying here, James is teaching us that while God doesn't want us to be partial to anyone, God has impartial and merited favor in salvation to the ones this world despises the more. Now it's weird to coin it impartial favor. Kasi di ba gasigidi tudlo si James, show no partiality. But why is it that God has a special favor, unmerited favor in salvation to the poor, the ones that this world despises the more? This is what James seems to be saying here. He's pointing to the reality of God's favor in salvation. He's saying that many, though not all, God has chosen the poor to salvation, the ones whom He chose to give His gracious and merited favor. And these many people are not rich, but rather the ones that this world despises the more. If you notice, after Jesus said, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom, nagsingke ang mga kilay sa mga disciples. They were puzzled. They wondered. Jesus, If it's harder for the rich to enter the kingdom, what will be left of us, the poor? They protested to Christ. Why? The Jews, since the Old Testament, have misunderstood that wealth is a sign of God's favor. That's why the friends of Job said, Job, just because you lost your wealth, right now you should not be righteous. And partly, it also has to do with the mentality of covenant-keeping blessings. Kaya ang basang ginoo sa Israel, simple lang ginoo, if you obey me, you will be blessed. If you disobey me, you will be cursed. So, if Christ would say that it's hard for the rich to enter the kingdom of God, though they are believed to be made more favored by Him, what then will be left of the poor? James is telling us, God, in His impartial, gracious, and merited favor, He chose to save many people. That's why in the version of Luke recorded Jesus saying, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God." So when we choose people by what we can see on the surface, if we judge them, if we prefer them based on their looks, or on their wealth, or on their status, we miss the mind of God, who has shown more favor to those whom the world despises. And what is more, we can say that God has chosen the poor in the sense that when He added humanity to His deity and came to earth, Christ came into poverty. I like what F.B. Mayer said. He said, "There's nothing that men dread more than poverty." Is this true? Are you scared of being poor? Man will break every commandment in the Bible rather than be poor. But it is God's chosen situation. Look at what He said. Jesus had one opportunity only of living our life, and He chose to be born of parents too poor to present more than two doves at His presentation in the temple. Just this week, akong devotion is ang law of purification sa babae. If you give birth to a male child, that woman will be unclean for 30 days. And after 30 days, she will bring her offering, that is burnt, a sin offering and burnt offering, to purify herself and to present her son or child to God. And classifies, you know, what kind of sacrifice that they could offer. If they can afford, they would bring a lamb. If they could not afford it, they would bring two turtle doves. That is the least that anyone can afford. Pero dua, and even two, Mary could not even afford. So Joseph, even though he was related to King David, when Christ came to this world, he chose to be born literally poor. Question. One may protest that if God does not want us to be discriminating of the poor, by God choosing the poor more than the rich, isn't He also showing partiality in favor of the poor over the rich? Is God anti-rich? Some sort of a Robin Hood or communist attitude. Okay, weird, diba? Verse 1, show no partiality. But why is it that when we come to verse 5, James would say, has not God chosen the poor over the rich? Is God anti-rich? Is He a communist? Nga kung mamati ka sa komunista, tanan na lang para sa pigado. They are fighting for the poor. Of course, God has not only chosen the poor, but we may say that He has chosen the poor first. He has also chosen some people who are rich to be saved. How do I know? 1 Corinthians 1, Paul is reminding the Corinthian believers, remember your calling, that when God called you unto salvation, not many of you are wise according to the world, not many of you were influential, or not many of you were born blue-blooded. Matthew Poole explained this, not that God has chosen all the poor in the world. It doesn't mean that when you're born poor, you're automatically chosen or you're automatically saved. But God's choosing is mainly of the poor. God has chosen greater favor, impartial favor, and merited favor to the poor, to the point that Calvin wrote God regarding God's choice of the poor, not indeed the poor alone. Because God chose some rich people to be a part of His kingdom. But so God wished to begin with the poor in the language of Paul in 1 Corinthians 1, that He might beat down the pride of the rich. That God may put the rich to shame. That God may put the wise to shame. That God may put the noble to shame. That just because you're noble, you're automatically entitled to be chosen or favored more by God in His kingdom. So in saying this, we should also remind ourselves that God also never calls for partiality against the rich. If we should not be partial against the poor, we should not hate the rich either. So if one must judge in a dispute between a rich man and a poor man, we should let the law and the facts of the case decide the judgment instead of the economic class of those in the dispute. Ano problema sa buong Amerika? They are fighting discrimination. They're protecting the minorities. But now, the minorities has automatic rights. Muna yung ginatawag nila race card or gender card. But just because you invoke your race or just because you invoke your gender, people would automatically side for you in judging any case. So while God has impartial and merited favor in salvation to the ones this world despises the more, God still doesn't want us to be partial to anyone. Diba ton ko ha? I-reverse na lang. God still doesn't want us to be partial to anyone. We treat the poor equally how we treat the rich. So if we give favor to the poor, we should not also give automatic hatred for the rich, because while God favors the poor more in His impartial and merited favor in salvation, He wants us to treat everyone fairly. Verse 6, but raising this question, he concluded that these Christians or believers have dishonored the poor man. As God has given unmerited favor to the poor, James tells these believers who are guilty of the sin of partiality directly that they have done just the opposite. They have dishonored the poor. So if God has shown favor to the poor of this world, these believers have dishonored. Last time, they have judged with evil thoughts. Now they have also dishonored the poor. They have insulted and treated with contempt, whether in word, deed, or thought, the poor who are coming into their assembly. That's why James reminded his readers that it is the rich that often sin against them. What did he say in verse 6? Are not the rich the ones who oppress you, drag you into court, who blasphemes the name, the honorable name by which you are called? The literal translation of the word oppress here is the word to tyrannize or tyrannize. Because the love of money is the root of every kind of evil. And for this reason alone, the rich are not worthy of the partiality often shown to them. Because history shows that the rich can indeed oppress the poor. John Trapp said, "The rich trample upon you with the feet of pride and cruelty, devour you as the greater fish do the lesser fish." In this world, it's always a man for his own. It's always the fittest that survives. It's always the biggest fish in the ocean eating up other smaller fishes. But this is a sin against race, grace, and place. So James is reminding them, why are you showing favor to the rich when they are the ones who are oppressing you? Isn't that weird? And these rich people are dragging you into court. What does that refer to? First, it could refer to a civil court. As frequently in the Old Testament, the wealthy often used the court system to steal from the poor. Amali Amos, ambasagino through Amos, you who are in Samaria, you oppress the poor, you crush the needy. Habakkuk 1, so the law is paralyzed, the justice never goes forth. Malachi 3:5, I will draw near to you for judgment. I will witness against you, against those who oppress the hired workers in his wages, the widow and the fatherless. So, it could refer to the rich taking advantage of the poor legally, using the legal system to their advantage. But two, it could also be a reference to religious courts, where wealthy Jewish opponents of Christ were harassing poor Christians. Christ predicted or prophesied, rich people, the enemies of the cross, will put you out of the synagogues legally. So the rich are the ones blaspheming the name of Christ, by which these poor believers are called. I think there are two ideas here with the thought of blasphemy. If the rich here were spoken of rich Christians, then they may be said to blaspheme the name of Christ when by their wicked ways they carry the name of Christ in a way that it caused it to be blasphemed by others. There are rich Christians who can oppress people. And by that kind of living, they also blaspheme the name of Christ. But if rich unbelievers here be meant, the rich men of those times being generally great enemies to Christianity. So James challenges his readers as to why they would honor the rich in the assembly when it is the rich unbelievers of the world who blaspheme the name of Christ. So this oppression, exploitation, reflects a situation of radical social polarization in the first century, with merchants and landowners taking land and possessions from the poor. In other words, the social problem of the gap, the gap between the rich and the poor is big. Because the rich people are taking advantage of the poor. Do you know who's the owner of True Network? Do you know who's the owner of Lotus? Do you know who's the owner of Macro? Do you know who's the owner of Subong Binakalpagin lang MG? They're the owner of 7-Eleven. It started with CP Hotdog. Inubos na nila tanan. It will become to a monopoly. Now they have bought DTAC. It's either they're wise in conducting their business, but the filthy rich gets more richer. And they devour the poor. I'm not saying that CP is automatically evil. That's why this situation was the primary reason for the revolts in Galilee. That led to the war of AD 70, and I think that's the reason why the Romans came, because the gap in the social divide is getting greater and greater. But the point of James here, he's trying to make in verse 6 and 7 is this: it's absurd for believers to treat the rich with preference when they are generally the ones we should stand up against for their exploitation or oppression against the poor and Christianity. This seems to be the point that James is trying to make when he asks these believers, why would they treat with preference the rich? It's absurd. Ilungguhon ko na, binuang. Do ka binuang? Why would you treat people who take advantage of you better? Why would you treat them better? Who are persecuting you as Christians? And they persecute you legally. Now, I would say generally, kaindi tanan, because there are rich unbelievers who do not exploit the poor, nor are they enemies of Christianity. Not long ago, I've watched Kapon Ying's interview of Lucio Tan. Sa puno, tag-iisang head sa San Miguel, Lucio Tan giman? Ramon Ang. He's one of the richest men in our country. And from what I gather in the interview, my impression of him is that he is a very down-to-earth, sociable, socially conscious, wealthy man who treats everyone fairly. He has the heart for the poor. How do I know? He talks about feeding stations for the poor, pagi sa Magnolia products or Pure Foods. Kaya feeding station, no? Tender juicy hot dog, guapo, no? He's been telling of how he is raising his kids to treat even the lowest in their house with dignity. He has the same driver for many years, which tells of the love his people have for him. He prefers to wear simple clothes. I think ang isa lang ka weakness is sports car. Muna daw siya ko nung ma-distributor sang Ferrari sa Pilipinas because he likes cars, nice cars. But surely there are also many rich unbelievers who exploit the poor. In English, we call them land grabbers, but in Negros, we could call them hashindiro. Si Don Salvador Benedicto. Hindi lang na yung alan sang Dan Banwagro, but tuto, ginaguro nga alan sang tao. We call them Don or Donya because of their wealth, but they may have been rich at the expense of poor farmers having their lands grabbed from them legally. Oppressive when it comes to giving wages. I'm not saying that every don or every doña or every rich person takes advantage of people, but companies even want to do it legally through the contractual workers. Ang kontrata taya, 6 months, 6 months lang, so that the company would pay the workers the least, don't give them benefits. Renew ta lang. But just because of the need, poor people has to bite on that contract. So James is saying, why would you prefer the rich when these are the people who are taking advantage of you? And they're the ones who are enemies of Christianity. Organized persecution of Christianity started with the oppression of Christ, the apostles and early believers funded and pushed by rich people. So I would say generally, because there are rich believers who do not exploit the poor nor oppress Christianity, because many rich believers are supporters of Christ's ministry. Si Lydia was a rich supporter of Paul's ministry. She was a businesswoman. She was a faithful giver, supporter of God. But are there also rich professing believers who can exploit the poor? Temanamali po, last time, masters, treat your slaves justly and fairly. Why should he command them to do this? Because there are rich, believing, professing, believing masters who can also treat their servants unjustly and unfairly. Last week, someone shared men in the group about partiality, that his co-worker asked him if their boss is really a Christian. Christian gimana busta? Pero ka lawai sa batasan niya, you know? When your Christianity is put into question because how you treat people, this is what James is saying. Why would you prefer the rich just because they dress better? Just because they're more sophisticated? Just because they have more power or influence? When they are the ones that we should stand up against. So James is telling them, it's absurd. I can't even fathom why you would prefer them, when in reality, they're the ones that we should stand up against. Dapat sila ni atong kontrahon, pero sila pag ginatagaan pabor. Verse 8, the third reason. If you really fulfill the law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing well. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. If you fulfill the royal law in The original, it means the law that belongs to the king, or it's better translated, sovereign law. Because our God is a great king, so his law is a royal law. The idea here is that this law that God gave is supreme, it's highest, and it's binding. It applies to everyone. And this sovereign law, when combined with the command to love God, summarizes all the law and the prophets. The specific reference here that came from God's royal law that James is quoting in verse 8 is, "You shall love your neighbor as yourself." If you combine this with love the Lord your God, it is the apex of kingdom rules for ethical conduct. It is the highest rule for ethical conduct. If there's one thing that God commands us to do, is love your neighbor as yourself. So James is telling them, if you really fulfill the royal law, you're doing well. But, verse 8, if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. Someone, I think a certain commentator noticed that the word if in verse 9, kaduwa nag-appearing if, diba? Verse 8 started with if, verse 9 also goes as, but if. The word in the Greek, if, can also sometimes be translated as sins. So kung islan mo na, since you are showing partiality, it indicates that this practice is not conditional. Kun. But if you translate this sins, it will come out as tumud. Meaning, they are already doing this. It is already happening. I like this explanation. Hamali David Gusik. Hamaya. James anticipated that some of his readers might defend their partiality to the rich simply as loving the rich man as their neighbor in obedience to the law. The way that we show partiality or we prefer the rich, that is how we show our love to our neighbor. Amuna naghambal gid si James sa verse 8, if this interpretation is true, you are doing well. Ilungguhon ko ha? If you claim that the way you prefer the rich is a way you show love to your neighbor, you are doing well. Love your rich neighbor. Kay may love kagid sa imong neighbor, pero rich lang ang neighbor. That is sarcasm. But verse 9 is telling us the problem is not that one is nice to the rich. The problem is that one does show partiality to the rich and is not nice to the poor man. So James is saying, you cannot excuse your partiality by saying, I'm just fulfilling the command to love my neighbor as myself, when in fact you're just loving one kind of person over the other. So James is reminding them that the poor man is just as much our neighbor as the rich man is. So verse 9, partiality then, is the direct opposite of the love command. Because favoritism towards the rich breaks the Old Testament commands to treat the poor equitably or equally, and is a serious transgression of God's law. And the form of the Greek in verse 9, sang show partiality, is in the present tense, indicates that the behavior of these believers was not an occasional slip, but a continual practice. It's been existing and they're continuing to do this. In other words, ang scenario last week, some verse 2 and 3, when a man comes into our assembly with fine clothing and a gold ring, meaning, manggarano nagsulod, you prefer him. You ask him to sit in a good place. That is already happening. It's not just a hypothetical case. They have been doing this and they're keeping on doing this. So verse 9, like a good lawyer, James is convicting them, humble ya. If you are committing this, or you're showing this, it is sin, and you're convicted by the law that you believe and you claim to be royal, you are a transgressor. Lesson. Favoritism and discrimination are sinful violations of the kingdom law of love. And the specific commands that they have violated is Deuteronomy 1, basing, you shall not be partial in judgment. You shall hear the small and the great alike. You shall not be intimidated by anyone. You shall not pervert justice. You shall not show partiality. You shall not accept a bribe. And coincidentally, sang aga, ang wali ni Brother John Ray was on the poor widow. I think the parable of the poor widow who came to a certain unjust judge. And isa sa ginpoint out niya sa iyang awali, sometimes ang mga judge would not hear your case if you do not give them a bribe. So that poor widow doesn't have enough money to bribe the assistant to bring the case or to have her case heard. But this is what God is saying. You shall not accept a bribe or show partiality, for you shall hear both the small cases and the great cases alike. You shall not be intimidated by anyone just because they're influential, just because they're wise, or just because they're rich. That's why Adam Clark said this commandment is a royal, law, not only because it is ordained of God and proceeds from His kingly authority, but because it is useful, suitable, and necessary to our present state. We give expression royal to whatever is excellent, noble, grand, or useful. So this becomes the excellent command of God, that we love our neighbor as ourselves. And that neighbor includes the rich, and that neighbor also includes the poor. James is not advocating some kind of emotional affection for oneself. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love yourself first before you love others. But Paul said to Timothy, people will be lovers of themselves. This is a sin. But rather, the command is to pursue meeting the physical need and the spiritual well-being of one's neighbors who are within our sphere of influence with the same intensity and concern one does naturally have for oneself. Hindi ka nagigman mapunggan. God is not commanding us to love ourselves. God is commanding us to have care for others as you naturally have care for yourself. That's why Paul commanded the Philippians to what? Do nothing from rivalry or conceit, but in humility, count others more significant than yourselves. Where does rivalry come from? I think pagabot sa chapter 4, James will also talk about this. Rambat ni Paul, rivalry comes because of selfishness. We consider others a rival. Siblings consider one another as rivals when what? We think that we're better than our brothers and our sisters. More deserving than anyone else. That pride becomes conceit. But humility can make us think of others better. So if you're humble enough and we can think that others are better, rivalry will go away and conceit will go away. Verse 4, normally Paul, let each of you look not only to his own interest, but also. Paul is not advocating for self-abandonment. Ngati, hindi ka na yung maligo, kaya unahon mong ibang paligo. Na? Or hindi ka na yung magkaon, kaya tanan na lang niya, tanan nga pigado, pakanon mo, so hindi ka na yung magkaon. He's not advocating for that. And I like the instruction, whenever we go up the airplane, di ba? Mga nanay, kung maghulog na ganing oxygen mask, suksok yan, ay mo kagalingon, antes bata mo. Kaya base, why ka man kusog, isuksok sa iya. Not only to your own interests, because naturally, we would care for ourselves. But let it not stop there. Because the royal law is this. Love your neighbor as yourself. So when we have favorites or we discriminate, Amali James, it's a clear sinful violation of the kingdom law of love. And this is big because his audience are Jews and they exalt the command of God in the Old Testament. So he's invoking the command of the Old Testament to tell them, you are violating it clearly. Lastly, verse 10 to 11, for whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for all of it. The law of God was considered an interdependent whole, and any violation constituted a breaking of the law as a whole. Jesus said, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. So favoritism makes one accountable or guilty, a legal term in Greek, for the whole law. The sense here is not that when we violate this command, we have violated every command, but in the sense that we have violated the law's unity. So although all sins are not equally damaging or heinous or lala, some sins can shatter the unity of God's law and render us transgressors, much like when we hit a window with a hammer at only one point. It will shatter and destroy the whole window. What James is doing here in verse 10 to 11 is this. He is guarding us against selective obedience. The sort that will pick and choose which commands of God should be obeyed and which can be safely disregarded. Because he anticipated his audience. Some of you will say, I did not kill anyone, or I'm not an adulterer. But James is telling them, you're equally sinful to God as a murderer or an adulterer if you also violate this law of loving your neighbor as yourself. Because you prefer the rich over the poor. So favoritism and discrimination are sinful violations of the kingdom law of love. So, in conclusion, verse 12, Humbly James, speak and act as those who are to be judged under the law of liberty. So believers must speak and act in accordance with the law of liberty and with a view to the coming judgment. This law of liberty, I think last time, nantanay sa chapter 1, verse 25. Itawag na kaisa, law of liberty. Because the law of Christ provides freedom from sin through the gospel. So, true freedom is the freedom to obey God and do what pleases Him. And James is telling us, one thing that pleases God is when we love our neighbor by treating everyone, rich and poor, with no partiality. Speak and act as those who will be judged by God under this law of freedom. I like what John Trapp explain about this. Amaya, it is called a law of liberty because it is freely and willingly obeyed by the regenerate or the believers who are born again, to whom when we obey it, it's not a burden, that we love the poor equally to the rich. It's freeing to obey this command. It's freeing to do what pleases God. Ramaya, we will be judged by God according to the law of liberty. Verse 13, he ends by saying, for judgment is without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy. This proverbial saying sums up the implications of verses 1 to 12, and it will transition to the discussion of faith without works in verse 14 to 26. But the statement in verse 13 is the core of the Roman law. They call it lex talionis, or the law of retribution. To the one who has shown no mercy, you will also be judged with no mercy. So to God's law, what is central is also this, in His justice. What you do to others will also be done to you in the day of judgment. So if you have shown no mercy to the poor, when it comes judgment day, God will also show you no mercy. Din naghalin, Matthew 7, last time, judge not so that you will not be judged. Gambalisos, the judgment you pronounce on others, the same measure will be given to you. So in other words, what verse 13 means here, a person who shows no mercy and compassion for people in need demonstrates that he has never responded to the great mercy of God. And as an unredeemed person will only receive strict, unrelieved judgment in eternal hell. But he ends verse 13 by saying, mercy triumphs over judgment. What does that mean? If you have shown no mercy to anyone, God will show you no mercy at judgment day. But mercy triumphs over judgment. In this context, it does not mean that God's mercy extended to believers at the judgment. Rather, believers' acts of mercy will mean that they will be vindicated. They will be victorious at the judgment day. So those who will judge or will be judged by the law of liberty, we should always show mercy to others by refraining from partiality. The mercy will show will be extended to us again on the day of judgment. And that is how mercy triumphs over judgment. Our last lesson is this. Professing believers who do not show mercy to the poor will be judged by God with no mercy. Amuto, last time, kung gaduda ka, if your co-worker are doubting the salvation of your boss who profess to be a believer because they don't show mercy to the poor, what James is saying here, maybe you are not saved. Because true believers who receive God's mercy will also show and share and put forward the same mercy received from God to the poor. That is how mercy triumphs over judgment. The same measure will be given to you. So if you have received God's mercy and shared that God's mercy on the day of judgment, God will also give you mercy. When I'm G. Campbell Morgan, the law of liberty is the law which defines our relationship to God and man as love mastered or controlled by love. To speak and do under that impulse is to be free indeed. If that law be disobeyed, if no mercy be shown, that judgment based upon that law will also show you no mercy. I mean, sarap lah. Kulbaan. So the person whose life is characterized by mercy will be ready for the judgment day. He will triumph over God's judgment by escaping all the charges that strict justice may bring against him, because by showing mercy to others, he gives genuine evidence of having received God's mercy. That's why Robert Moffat explained that the law of freedom is not laxity, but a strict ethical rule of God. Just because it's called the law of freedom doesn't allow us to be free to do whatever we want, to be free to choose whomever we want to love. But we shall be judged by our adherence to its supreme principle of brotherly love or mercy. Or as he would coin this, the merciful life will triumph in the face of judgment. So professing believers who do not show mercy to the poor. So pangamuyuin yun yung boss na nag-profess ng Kristohanon pero waay kaluoy sa mga ultimo or sa mga pigado, because someday they will give account to God by being merciless, by being cold-hearted, by being severe kind of a boss. But true believers who have received God's mercy will show that evidence of mercy by being merciful to the poor. So to close this morning, dua ton application number one. Blessed are the poor in spirit, who are chosen by God to be rich in faith and heirs of His kingdom. Have you ever wished that you were born in a rich family? Have you ever wished that you were born with a better life or opportunities? I don't know with you. I think the world through movies have depicted that the ideal life is the life of the rich. Hindakan ko nga movies hanggang may Batman. Batman is rich. He hides under that mask, but he goes to a very big home. He's a mogul. Iron Man is rich. Thai movies often have ang first pa lang na scene sa mga drama-drama, kunu, Disney princess, kunchai, Disney prince. They are the lead actors. So how we wish, sige tapaglantos ang scene, isang gamay pag kami, si Richie Rich. Kabi siya, may salakyan sa sulod balay. May kami salakyan sa sulod balay. Ano gusto niya? Kaunon mo, order niya lang. But the Bible tells us that the poor, especially the poor in spirit, are blessed. Why? Because they have the condition of being richer in faith. Because they have no one to cling to but God. So do you despise the condition that you're born with? Do you despise the family that you grew up with? Do you despise the neighborhood and the social condition that you grew up with? Kamiyara iba niya, hindi naging kuliya magbalik. Hayob-hayob sa uma. Duta ang salug. Romani Jesus, blessed are you who are poor, especially you who are poor in spirit. Why? Yours is the kingdom of God. So blessed are those who are poor in spirit. Because you have the condition, embedded condition of expressing faith in the Lord. But don't make the mistake of being poor in this world, yet you're also poor in faith. And you don't get to be heirs of God's kingdom. I thank God that I came from my previous church, and that town is called by the DILG as Jida, geographically isolated, depressed area. Grabe man yung classifications ng lugar man. Isolated na, kaya may nakatultol sa mapa, magsiling ka din kagapastor sa Limeri. Sino nakakilala sa Limeri? Isolated, depressed area. Meaning, it's a fancy term for pugpigado. I'm surrounded by poor people. I'm in a poor town. But I realize there are many poor there who are rich in faith. But you know who's the most miserable? The poorest of the poor, and yet don't have the heart for God. Amo gina yung kaluluoy sa tanan. Pigado ka na gani, mapaimpirno ka pa, ay abaw. You're the most miserable of all. You're poor in this world, and you're poor in the world to come. So don't make the mistake of being poor in this world, and yet you're also poor in faith. And you don't get to be an heir of God's kingdom. If I'm not a Disney princess in this world, I don't care. I will become a princess in heaven, in God's kingdom. And last question, why should believers treat everyone with no partiality, preference, or discrimination? I-summarize na lang ang mga principles ng ginhambal ni James, then we go to our last application, verse 2 to 4. First reason, preferential treatment for the rich and discrimination of the poor are evil thoughts and judgments. It's evil. Discrimination or preference is evil. 2, God has chosen many believers who are poor to be rich in faith and heirs of His kingdom. This is the only positive reason. 3, It is absurd for believers to treat the rich with preference when they are generally the ones who exploit and oppress the poor and Christianity. Verse 8 to 11, failing to do so is a violation against the God, or God's royal law of love. Verse 12 to 13, when we have preference or discrimination, it is a reflection that we, that they have not received God's mercy, so God will judge them without mercy. So if this is the scenario that James is presenting in verse 2 to 3, Gasimbata, a rich man comes in, and also a poor man comes in. What then should be the scenario when we are living according to the biblical command? Because this church and these believers that James is writing to, they have failed in this scenario. This is the scenario that God desires from us. My last application is this. Let us treat everyone impartially, with value, dignity, and mercy, in obedience to God's royal law of love and freedom. So then we will treat everyone, and that includes the rich and the poor. We treat them with value, with dignity, and the mercy that God has given us in obedience to His royal law of love and freedom. Now, history would show that where the true gospel of Christ is, or where the true gospel is an influence, there will be impartial treatment of people in society with value, dignity, and mercy. Slavery was abolished in America by Abraham Lincoln, which theologians believe to be more likely influenced by Christian ideals. Here in Thailand, it was abolished by King Chulalongkorn. I think nag-holiday ta last Monday in celebration of him. One of his contributions for this country is abolishing slavery, most likely influenced by the British Christian ideals. Because prior to that, even the words we used, pom, halinagali sa concept nga above my head, or above my hair. You address yourself as someone lower. Dichan comes from a Buddhist concept or a Sanskrit concept of a lower animal. And that is how a woman would address herself. I am lower than the male, and I'm lower than you, who is a human being. Kamiya sapat. That's the meaning of the word dichan. So you're calling yourself a low animal. But when the Christian ideals influence a society, it brings out dignity and value and mercy that God desires from each of us, from His royal law of love and freedom. Now, there's a certain movie I watched many years ago. This is a painful movie to watch. It's entitled 12 Years a Slave. It is a story in the years before the Civil War about a free black man who came from New York. He was kidnapped and sold into slavery in the South. So he was subjected to one malevolent or evil owner, but he also finds unexpected kindness from another. But I brought out this movie because there's one certain strange character in this movie played by Brad Pitt. Antawa nyo lang ni pertinikalawi, pertinikasakit ng sine. But Brad Pitt in this movie was a preacher. Gawali siya, gasimba siya, but when he comes home and goes to his slave, he treats his slaves with cruelty. And I think this is what's happening in the church that James is writing to. You're claiming to be a believer, but when you go home or when you receive people, you receive them with partiality and discrimination. This should not happen in the life of a believer. This should not happen inside the church. Because in the church, everyone has to be seen and heard. They have to be valued. We should see and hear the poor. But we do not also automatically despise or shut out the rich. Salamat ko sa Ginoo, Bla, that my first church was a microcosm or a small example size of what a society would be. Damo, mga pigado, pero may ara man sa may kasarang. So I'm naturally drawn to visit homes who are poor. Namiyan ko yung magtambay upod sa ila, kaya kasimple lang. Siyempre, way ko ga-announce pa rin isla ka-preparar sang cokes, kagpamahaw, uyaman ko. Iti, napilitan sila. But I like to hang out with them. But it doesn't mean I'm not friends with our rich brethren. Because everyone has to feel that we are of equal value and importance regardless of our gender, race, wealth, or status. So there should be no second-class member in our church. While we are predominantly Filipino, duwa or tatlo lang aton Thai, we should never make them feel that they are inferior to us in any way. We may be separated by language, but they can feel it from how we treat them. That's why we'll end with these verses. Romans 13:8. All together, ready, begin. Owe no one anything
except to love each other, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law.
What does it mean? Ilungguhon ko, dapat wala kamu utang sa ibang tao. Don't owe anyone anything except for this thing, that you love each other. For when you do, you are fulfilling the royal law of God. That law is the law of love and the law of freedom. We should live debt-free except for one thing. Our debt to one another is that we owe each other love. That's why Paul summarizes the commandments. Each commandment is summed up in this word: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. So I don't commit adultery, murder, or covet, or steal, because I love my neighbor. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, when you love, you are obeying God's command. So the church should then go out and allow everyone to be seen and be heard. In this church, there should be no preferential treatment nor discrimination, so that when we go out in our schools, in our communities, everyone will be seen and will be heard. Nabalangin kami sa amon maestra sang college Mangaranon to sa mo, I think siyempre atinista sa Manila. Ang panit do maharlika kaya. But she would teach us in our class that when you go out, you greet the guards, you greet the cleaning ladies, you greet them with respect, you treat them with respect. Just because they are in a lower segment of our society doesn't mean that they should not be seen or be heard. That's why I will close with this story. It's a story about a certain teacher named Miss Thompson. She was a school teacher who every year would say to her students, "Boys and girls, I love you all the same. I have no favorites." Of course, she wasn't being completely truthful, because teachers do have favorites. Is that true? What's worse, most teachers have students they simply don't like. So Teddy Stallard was a boy that Miss Thompson simply didn't like, and for a good reason. Teddy didn't seem interested in school. He wore a blank expression on his face, he is numb, he is inexpressive, and his eyes were glassy and unfocused. When she spoke to Teddy, he merely shrugged his shoulders, though I'm a ding bata, di man. His clothes were a mess, and his hair unkempt. He wasn't an attractive boy, and he certainly wasn't likable. So whenever she marked Teddy's paper, she got a certain perverse pleasure out of putting X's next to the wrong answers. When she put F's at the top of the paper, she did it with a flair. But she should have known better. She had Teddy's records, and she knew more about him than she wanted to admit. Here is what the records read. Grade 1, Teddy shows promise with his work and attitude, but he has a poor home situation. Grade 2, that Teddy could do better. His mother is seriously ill, so he receives little help at home. Grade 3, Teddy is a good boy, but he's too serious. He's a slow learner. His mother died this year. Grabe nga school record, no? Ginasulat niya. Grade 4, Teddy is very slow, but he's well-behaved. His father shows no interest. So at Christmas, the boys and girls in Miss Thompson's class brought her presents, piled them on her desk, and crowded around to watch her open them. Among the presents was one from Teddy Staller. She was surprised that he had brought her a gift. Teddy's gift was wrapped in brown paper and held together with scotch tape. On the paper were written simple words, "For Miss Thompson from Teddy." When she opened Teddy's present, out fell a gaudy rhinestone bracelet, meaning burluloy nga imitation, with the half the stones missing and a bottle of cheap perfume. The other boys and girls began to giggle and smirk over Teddy's gifts, but Miss Thompson at least had enough sense to silence them by immediately putting on the bracelet and dotting some of the perfume on her wrist. Holding her wrist up for the other children to smell, she said, "Doesn't it smell lovely?" The other children, taking their cue from the teacher, readily agreed. When the school was over and the other children had left, Teddy lingered behind. He slowly came over to her desk and said softly, "Miss Thompson, you smell just like my mother. And her bracelet looks really real pretty on you too. I'm glad you like my present." When Teddy left, Miss Thompson got down on her knees and asked God to forgive her. The next day, when the children came to school, they were welcomed by a new teacher. Miss Thompson had become a different person. She was no longer just a teacher. She had become an agent of God, committing to loving her children and doing things for them that would live on after her. She helped all the children, but especially with the slow ones, and especially Teddy Stallard. By the end of that school year, Teddy showed dramatic improvement. He caught up with the most of the students and was even ahead of some. Once the school year ended, Miss Thompson didn't hear from Teddy Stallard for a long time. Then one day, she received a note that read, "Sobra kanipis, no? Kitaan lang. Gigindaan ni Teddy. Dear Miss Thompson, I wanted you to be the first to know I will be graduating second in my class. Love, Teddy Stallard." Four years later, another note came. "Dear Miss Thompson, they just told me I will be graduating first in my class. I wanted you to be the first to know. The university has not been easy, but I have good 4 years." And 4 years later, as of today, I'm Theodore Stallard, MD. "I wanted you to be the first to know. I'm getting married next month, the 27th to be exact. I want you to come and sit where my mother would sit if she were alive. You are the only family I have now. Dad died last year." Miss Thompson went to that wedding and sat where Teddy's mother would have sat. She deserved to be there. She had done something for Teddy that he could never forget. Many people around us need someone to believe in them and build them up rather than tear them down. When we see someone who is different from us or handicapped or lonely or poor, we can tease them and put them down. Or we can do what Jesus would do, show kindness, love, and encouragement. We can also become agents of God as we reach out to help those who are rejected by others or those who have great needs that we have become aware of. So let us treat everyone impartially, that when people are around us, they would feel that they are valued, they would feel that they have dignity, that they would feel that they are seen and they are heard. Because you are obeying God's royal law to love your neighbor as yourself. And when you obey this law of freedom, you are pleasing God. So may we go out and let the world be seen and be heard because we have obeyed Christ. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, give us a deeper repentance, a horror of sin, a dread of its approach. Help us chastely to flee it and jealously to resolve that our hearts shall be yours alone. Give us a deeper trust that we may loose ourselves to find ourselves in you, the ground of our rest, the spring of our being. Give us a deeper knowledge of yourself as Savior, Master, Lord, and King. Give us a deeper power in private prayer, more sweetness in your word, more steadfast grip on its truth. Give us deeper holiness in speech, thought, action. Let us not seek moral virtue apart from you. This is our prayer in the name of Christ. Amen. Let us stand and let us sing our song of the month for the last time. Your will be done. Victim to discrimination, or even at times you have failed by preferring one type of people over the other, showing more favor to them, when in fact you have commanded us to love each of our neighbor, every neighbor, rich or poor, whoever, whatever they are. We are obligated by your law of love to treat them with value, with dignity and mercy that you desire from us to do. So I pray, Lord, that you would continue to work in our hearts, that as we receive your mercy, we will show the same mercy to anyone and to everyone, to treat no one with partiality, but rather to treat everyone equally with value and dignity as they deserve to be treated, as image bearers that you have created. So Lord, I pray that this church would be a prime example of what it means to be valued, to be seen and to be heard. That we will not be divided by race or status or gender, and that we would glorify you in all things. And we can only do this by the name and what Christ has done on the cross for us, that we can together pray, not our wills, but yours be done. So we thank you, O Lord, for the blessing of this fellowship, the blessing of the worship this morning, the blessing from your word that continues to sustain us, teach us, rebuke us, transform us, and conform us to the image of your dear Son, Jesus Christ. And as we leave this place, Lord, I pray that our lives will become a blessing, a channel of your mercy, to anyone and to everyone. May the love of God the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.
And though the temperature drops,
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for worshiping with us today, and may God bless us.